1961 was still under the spell of modernism. Paul Rudolph, the dean, had been a student of Walter Gropius, founder of the Bauhaus, and the fire of the modern movement was still alive. Yale was full of strong teachers, but it was dominated by Rudolph. He was the man who taught Foster how to draw like an architect, and even how to look like one. Rudolph also made him cry. He used the words, "You don't care enough," to Norman, after he'd been up all night working on a project.
Yale never had a kind of ideology, and Rudolph was particularly good at bringing out the best of every student. He was tough on them. He was famously tough and rigorous, but it was about bringing out what you wanted to do.
Rudolph really encouraged Norman. He really pushed him. With most of us, he pushed us, or you would be out. But I think he pushed Norman more than anybody in our group. I think he saw things in Norman that most of us did not see them.
Also on the teaching staff was Serge Chemaev. He wanted to make them think about communities, about how they worked, and he was the one who was pushing Norman to thinking about how you design a whole world, a whole environment. Vincent Scully, the other great force at Yale, was a historian who was passionate about making architecture come alive for his students.
Vince Scully and Rudolph were all very much about the visual, how you saw things, how you approached things, how things unwound as you looked at them from different angles.
Scully was the one who encouraged both Norman and Richard to drive across America. They went on pilgrimages to look at great architecture.
As we drove into the city of Chicago in my VW bug, and it had one of those windows in the top, the whole crew, not Sue, but Richard and Norman, kept, and it was freezing. I mean, it was like snow everywhere, wanting the top to be open while we were driving so they could take photographs of the oil derricks and the big things all around Chicago, going into the city.
It was where the idea that they would start a partnership one day was born.
El Centro Cultural Carré d'Art en Nîmes, en el sur de Francia, alberga un museo de arte contemporáneo así como la biblioteca municipal. Construido justo enfrente de un templo romano que data del siglo I a.C. Para celebrar el vigésimo aniversario de su construcción, el arquitecto británico Norman Foster ha querido estrenarse como curador de arte y reunir sus obras favoritas en una muestra titulada Movimiento.
Es una elección muy intuitiva. Si una obra me conmueve, ya sea emocional o intelectualmente, me basta para elegirla. De ahí también el nombre de la exposición.
Norman Foster ha revolucionado la escena del arte internacional al asociar trabajos del chino Ai Weiwei, esculturas del italiano Umberto Boccioni y pinturas del alemán Gerhard Richter. Obras que el británico ha tomado prestadas de museos de todo el mundo. Al igual que esta fotografía del alemán Andreas Gursky.
El arte, la arquitectura y el diseño, ya sea de autos, aviones o muebles, están estrechamente relacionados. Y aquí obviamente he tenido que separarlos, porque me he concentrado solo en el arte. Pero con mi familia vivo rodeado de obras. En cierto modo, esto representa una ampliación de mi forma de ver el arte.
Con la particularidad de que ha escogido uno de sus edificios para presentar la exposición. El Centro Cultural presenta un diseño típico de Foster, amplio y traslúcido. De hecho, la biblioteca adjunta apenas necesita luz artificial. El edificio se extiende a lo largo de 9 plantas, 5 de ellas bajo tierra. Las obras seleccionadas están por todas partes. Por ejemplo, esta instalación colgante de Olafur Eliasson.
Es mi inspiración. En mi opinión, las alusiones a la arquitectura son más subliminales. Uno no puede apreciar a simple vista la conexión directa, aunque para mí como arquitecto existen esas conexiones.
Foster fundó su estudio en Londres hace 46 años. Ahora tiene a su cargo a unos 1,000 trabajadores en todo el mundo. Y entre sus obras más conocidas figuran la sede de la Swiss Reinsurance Company de Londres, la Torre Hertz de Nueva York, el viaducto de Millau en Francia y la cúpula del Parlamento Alemán en Berlín.
Si tomamos el caso del Parlamento Alemán, como obra arquitectónica es inseparable de las contribuciones de muchos artistas que intervinieron.
En el Centro Cultural Carré d'Art en Nîmes, Foster no presenta únicamente a figuras de renombre. También hay lugar para artistas menos conocidos que lograron conmoverlo.
Espero poder acercarlas a un público más amplio como si fuera a través de mi mirada. No he respetado ninguna regla. Si he sentido que dos obras tienen alguna relación visual o emocional, las he colocado juntas.
Foster tiene una concepción del arte propia y eso también se aprecia en la muestra. Ese es su distintivo.
El berlinés Daniel Lergon decoró la enorme pared en el vestíbulo del Centro Cultural. Contiene numerosas referencias a la arquitectura de Norman Foster.
El museo tiene una gran apertura, y no solo arquitectónica. Aquí hay una biblioteca, actividades para niños en el primer piso, y el museo está arriba. Como estructura, me parece muy interesante.
Foster tardó 9 años en construir el Carré d'Art. La muestra le ha brindado la oportunidad de sentir el edificio de una forma completamente nueva.
Vuelvo a visitar mis edificios y los contemplo desde diferentes estados de ánimo, con distintas exhibiciones. Para mí supone una parte importante del proceso de diseño, ver cómo un edificio se desgasta a lo largo del tiempo, cómo cambia, cómo se adapta a su entorno. Es parte de un proceso de aprendizaje continuo.
It's not a building, and it's not the physicality of a studio. It's the philosophy, the way in which, beyond my lifespan, that will move on and have its own life. That, I think, is the most difficult design of all, and the one I'm most proud of. It is a belief in a youth, in the energy of youth and the optimism of youth. And in the end, the ultimate test is, you know, do you continue to attract the greatest young talent? And wonderfully, the average age of the company is the same now as it was when we were two or three people in 1967. It's still early 30s, 32.
You're thrown into the deep end, and I think that's what's really interesting about this place, is how they integrate you into the process. And everyone becomes part of that process, because it is, all of the projects here are always a journey. You start very, you know, about the brief and the client. There's never a stylistic goal that comes from Norman. He doesn't say it should look like this and we develop it for the next years. It's a whole journey. It's constantly changing and developing.
As a team, we've reinvented the genre, we've reinvented the airport, we've reinvented the nature of a high-rise building, reinvented the relationship of the old and new in terms of, you know, how you create a new life cycle for a historic building, keeping the best of its identity from the past. And perhaps all of us, in one way or another, reinvent ourselves in terms of changing circumstances, or from experience or knowledge, or feeding off new challenges.
Technology has always been at the heart of architecture. If you go back to the 19th century, the birth of fireproof construction enabled buildings to go higher. If you take the Lisbon earthquake centuries ago, it was the invention of seismic structures. So technology enables buildings to survive earthquakes. If you take the birth of the elevator, of sanitation, of water. It's all technology. It's part of an unfolding sequence. For as long as I've been practicing as an architect, I've been practicing green architecture before it became known as green architecture. All of the huge amount of space in a city that's devoted to the automobile, imagine that that's not needed anymore. It shrinks. What happens to those parking structures? Or you take agriculture. Why, in an age where water is going to be more scarce, would you do it in the country and have to transport it to the city? So if you put these trends together, you could see the city becoming greener. You could see urban agriculture, delicious food produced, maybe. Those parking structures are perfect. You don't need water. You don't need the amount of space. So the city could be greener, quieter, cleaner, and that offer a higher quality of lifestyle. I think that it's tragic that an airport like that, where billions have been spent, arguably it would cost more to stop that project than it would to have finished it. And eventually, Mexico City, like any other city, has to have a significant hub to function as a modern city. You can't do a conversion job on two military airfields with a mountain in between. It's merely a matter of time before eventually that realization will happen.
Here we see a practice concerned with individual buildings. But the bigger picture of the city, of infrastructure, of change, how do we address those in ways that no individual practice is equipped to do so? If over my professional life I've acted as an architect and still do, but also created an environment to amplify a philosophy which is about breaking down the barriers between different skills, a marriage of skills. So to apply that experience, those lessons, at the bigger picture of the city, of the planet, issues of climate change, of pollution, energy, those need bigger picture thinking, and also to anticipate the future, to educate, to inform younger generations, those involved with the city and issues of infrastructure, global issues, architects, urbanists, engineers, to break down the barriers between those skills, to encourage a holistic approach to design. Because that really, that's the answer to our survival. Perhaps to see the future, first you have to look far back. You look far back, then you see continuity. You see the same themes repeating. And maybe now we can do some of the things which were dreams before. And some of the things from the past would defy us today. What we can dream today will be reality tomorrow. I think the future of our society has to be cities.
La ciudad ideal es amable con el peatón. Tiene usos varios. Es una experiencia a tiempo completo. Es lo contrario a la ciudad expandida, que obliga a depender de un vehículo. Es un vecindario. Y el vecindario es parte de otros barrios que se juntan para crear la ciudad. Después, deberemos utilizar nuestra capacidad de promoción, de persuasión, para demostrar las ventajas de las comunidades más estrechas y más densas. Creo que hay patrones que demuestran que si se hace una mejor utilización de la red de carreteras, no haría falta construir más carreteras. Creo que la ciudad va a ser mucho más interactiva. Si queremos conocer el nivel de contaminación de nuestro entorno, podremos saberlo de forma instantánea. De hecho, ya podemos usar aplicaciones para saber si queremos ir a un destino que está al otro lado del río. ¿Llegaremos antes andando? O en coche, o según sea la distancia, en un transporte público u otro. Son las conexiones, los puentes, las carreteras, las calles, los espacios públicos, el transporte público, las conexiones. Se trata de que los distintos departamentos de la ciudad trabajen conjuntamente y se comuniquen entre ellos. Los que se ocupan de los residuos, por ejemplo, no los cogen y se deshacen de ellos, sino que trabajan con los que se dedican a generar energía. Así, los residuos se convierten en energía. Hay una vuelta de tuerca interesante, y es que el modelo de expansión urbana cambiará gracias a los coches robotizados, y puede que también lo haga incluso el modelo de transporte público. Porque si los vehículos pueden comunicarse entre ellos, si pueden trabajar codo con codo, sería como ir en tren, pero por carretera. Así se convierte en tiempo de esparcimiento, ya que durante el viaje uno puede ir leyendo el equivalente electrónico de un periódico. Y va seguro y va cómodo. Luego están los edificios, considerados individualmente. Estos interactúan con la naturaleza. Emplearán ventilación natural en la medida de lo posible. Modificarán el aire, calentándolo si hace frío y enfriándolo si hace calor. Lo ideal es que la tecnología nos vaya acercando a nuestras raíces. Cuando se trata de cambio, yo sugiero que la única constante sea el cambio. Por ejemplo, un edificio como el Willis Fader de los años 70 fue concebido en la era de las máquinas de escribir. 5 años después de construirlo, las máquinas de escribir habían desaparecido. Llegó la revolución digital. Muchas empresas tuvieron que construir nuevos edificios para albergar la nueva tecnología, pero el edificio sostenible definitivo es el que puede ser reciclado de cara al cambio, en especial los edificios históricos. Si tomamos un edificio como el Reichstag o el Museo Británico o el Smithsonian en Washington, son ejemplos de edificios que se han adaptado al cambio. ¿Cómo transformar las favelas, los barrios bajos, los asentamientos irregulares, la mortalidad infantil, la esperanza de vida, la libertad, la emancipación, la ilustración? Las sociedades más avanzadas, que tienen esas cualidades, tienen abundancia energética. Pero si queremos poner estos elementos en contexto, imagina todos los aviones del mundo, todos los camiones, todos los coches y todos los barcos, y piensa en toda esa energía en términos de combustible fósil. Aún es inferior a la que consume la industria cárnica. Así que cuando comas una hamburguesa o cortes un filete, tienes que poner eso en perspectiva. Si queremos construir un asentamiento lunar, tenemos que enviar la mínima cantidad de tecnología, de peso, de material. Se podría enviar una estructura inflable con un robot y una cantidad mínima de material. Ese robot mezclaría el polvo lunar con una especie de pegamento. Después, robóticamente, sobre una estructura compuesta de aire, como la goma espuma, el robot lo construiría capa sobre capa sobre capa, imitando la estructura ósea de humanos y animales, porque la naturaleza crea estructuras muy, muy eficaces. Mucho de lo que los futurólogos predecían para el futuro ya se ha hecho realidad. Así que creo que es cuestión de tiempo. Creo que conquistar lo desconocido está en la naturaleza humana. Subir a la cima más alta, construir el edificio más alto. Si algo existe, ir allí, colonizarlo, vivir allí.
Coincidiendo con la reciente apertura de la Fundación Norman Foster en Madrid, el espacio Fundación Telefónica organiza una exposición que recoge los aspectos menos llamativos de la obra del arquitecto, pero quizá los más importantes. Conceptos como la sostenibilidad, la ecología, la salud o la calidad de vida son los ejes de esta muestra que reúne 30 maquetas, 160 dibujos y contenido audiovisual.
Perhaps another side of the kind of projects that excite me. The tallest, the highest, the longest, but this is about continuity, demonstrating that the social imperative and technology as a means to social ends, issues such as climate change, inequality, the smaller projects which can make a big difference, and really showing the recurring themes over a 50-year period, whether that is ecology, talking about a green architecture before the word was even invented. So everybody's familiar perhaps with our experiment in Masdar, which is showing how in a desert you can sustain with solar energy a university 24 hours, 7 days. What is not known is that in the 1970s, we were pioneering projects about recycling, breathing buildings, buildings that would work with nature, concepts of small centers for health, for well-being, which anticipated a project like Maggie's, a small care center. So a lot of the later, bigger works are rooted in smaller projects, and those smaller projects continue now and into the future. So really the exhibition is about looking to the future, but as somebody said, perhaps to see the future, first you have to look far back. I think the future of our society has to be cities. More and more people live in cities, and the majority of the world's planet will be eventually living in cities. Madrid is a beautiful example of a sustainable city. You can walk easily, it has good public transport, it has a climate which you can work with and create buildings which breathe. It's the ideal European compact city with a great quality of life.
The pandemic will seem to change everything, but really nothing will change because the trends which are inevitable will accelerate. Everything will happen faster. Buildings will be healthier. Outdoor spaces will be healthier. The city will be greener. At the micro level, that's one thing. In security, those doors will open for us, others will close for us through facial recognition. But again, all those trends are apparent. At the global level, we will question the degree of globalization, a better balance between global and local, and we will appreciate, perhaps in a lasting way, the efforts of those who serve us, particularly health workers.
Many different agendas within this building, but above all, a celebration of the public domain. So the idea that you could ascend to the roof of Parliament, that you could look down into the chamber, that symbolically the public were above the politicians because the politicians were answerable to the public. The idea that you could ascend a ramp, that you would have a viewing platform, and that it was an ecological manifesto, an energy manifesto, carbon neutral, not using fossil fuels, dramatically reducing the carbon footprint. So all of these, together with incorporating works of art from each of the occupying forces in the past, it was hugely controversial. There was a political faction that was determined to cover it all up, so much so that at one point we commissioned, as a family, a record of all of those imprints. The masonry had exploded in a fire, the pockmarks of bullets. That is more powerful, though, than any photograph, the reality of that. And it's interesting, it still has the power to shock.
My advice to a young artist, a young architect, is, first of all, does architecture or art, sculpting, painting, drawing, is that what you really, really want to do more than anything else in the world? And you would do anything to be able to do it, because it really, really fires you. If that's the case, you've made the right choice, and you go for it, and you immerse, totally saturate it, you live it every living second of your life. If you don't believe in it that much, then you have to find something that you believe in, something else. And it doesn't really matter what it is, because in life, I think you'll find that everything is creative.